You know, a lot of people don't realize D-Day, they wrote a lot of books and a lot of movies about it. The whole D-Day was only 18 hours. We dropped the boats at 4 o'clock in the morning, and 10 o'clock at night, the beach was ours. It was only 18 hours, the whole thing. People make a big spectacle out of it, you know, D-Day, D-Day. It was 18 hours, that's all it was. But we did lose 2,000 men on the beach. I said men, I shouldn't say men. 2,000 kids. We were all kids. We were all kids. We were too young to drink. We were too young to vote. We weren't too young to die. 18 years old, 19, 20 years old, they were kids. Some of them didn't even shave, never shaved. You're fighting Germans that were in the war for 4 years. Some of them came out of Russia. They were seasoned. And with all that, the seasoned, us 18, 20-year-old kids, we ripped their ass.
Yes, indeed.
Sorry.
No, that's all right.
I shouldn't use that language.
That's all right.
What I remember the most. I'm going to tell you a story. I don't tell it to anybody because it's so hard for me. On the first wave, my job was to drop the ramp. And the machine guns were hitting the ramp in the front of the ramp. But I knew when I dropped the ramp, the machine gun was going to come into the boat. But I had to drop the ramp because the troops had to get out. This is the first wave. So when I dropped the ramp, the Germans had 14 machine guns, MG-42 machine guns, capable of 160 rounds a minute. When I dropped the ramp, all those machine guns opened up. And in the front of my boat, 7, 8, 10, 15 kids, I don't know, they just went down like you're cutting wheat. Now, I was three quarters of the way back because I had to take the ramp and drop the ramp. So I was three quarters of the way back. So I had some protection because the kids that were in front of me, the troops that were in front of me, they absorbed the bullets that were supposed to hit me. And they were falling down. And there was two kids, stragglers, I call them stragglers. They kept back because they didn't want to be in front of the boat because they knew they would die. So they stayed back and they stayed near me, which is a bad thing because besides the machine guns on the beach, there was a machine gun in the hill and they were shooting down from the hill. So that's in a crossfire. And these two boys, since they stayed close to me, they were drawing fire to me. Now, the first boy was about 4 feet away from me. He got a machine gun in his stomach. His stomach was sticking out of his. Luckily, that kid, somehow, he survived the war, even though his stomach was ripped open. The second kid, he was about two feet away from me. He wasn't so lucky. The machine gun took his helmet off and part of his skull. And he was crying, "Help me, help me, help me." And he fell at my feet. and I couldn't help him. I had no morphine, I had nothing to help him. Now the coxswain had to get the boat. There was all obstacles in the water. There was mines in the water. And we were right in the middle of them. And there was telephone poles. And the top of the telephone poles was the mine. Just sitting there. It wasn't nailed down or screwed down. It was just sitting on top of the telephone pole. If your boat nudged that telephone pole, the mine would come in your boat, killing everybody. Now, these were not an ordinary mine. These were telemines. A telemine, when they explode, they don't explode up. They explode sideways, take a man's legs off. So the coxswain, God bless him, he was so good. He got us out of this mess. And we headed back towards my ship. And we had a lot of boys that were wounded pretty bad, and they were crying, "Mama, Mama, Mama." And when we headed towards my ship, we saw this big white ship with a red cross on the side. It was a hospital ship. So instead of going towards my ship, we went towards the hospital ship, because we figured if we can get some of these wounded guys aboard that hospital ship, maybe we could save some lives. If we could save one life, it was worth it. So we pulled alongside the hospital ship, and two angels jumped in my boat. I called them angels because they did something we couldn't do. We were spent. We couldn't do anything. And what they did, they peeled off the dead soldiers to get to the wounded soldiers. And they were able to get about seven, I don't remember exact. Could have been seven, could have been eight, I don't know. And they got these wounded boys, and they put them in the hospital ship. And I said to myself, I said, thank God, these kids stand a chance. Maybe they're going to live this day. I'm alive. And I got to make a decision. Do I stay aboard the ship and let somebody take my place? Or do I go back into the belly of the beast and face those machine guns again? And I said to myself, this is what I was trained to do. And I made 15 trips. They told me, I didn't know that. They told me we made 15 trips with my boat. The PA-2628 made 15 trips.